So my name is John Martens and I work in the Department of Medical Oncology, and today I'll present our academic center in InnovaBIM, which we recently renamed, was initially called Molecular Biomarkers in Medicine. And I give you my perspective of this ACE, but also how ACEs in my view should work, because an ACE alone cannot work. You have to collaborate it, and since we work on biomarkers mostly in cancer for myself, I have to collaborate it, for instance, with the Academic Breast Cancer Center, with the Academic Urogenital Cancer, and as well as colorectal cancer. So for biomarker research to work, we have to collaborate. And that's the first connection. The second connection is the biology, which is related to those diseases. So we have to collaborate with other disciplines. For instance, DNA repair is critically important in cancer. Hereditary, there is an hereditary component in cancer. And also, for instance, more recently, tumor immunology is very important in biomarker research. So we can only work if these ACEs work together, and particularly at the cross-discipline between the ACEs, this will be very effective. And of course, we are not alone. We work together with other institutes and other academic centers to make this even more effective. Even international collaborations are there necessary. So our strategy, our aim we are an expertise network. So we have expertise, and which is necessary to discover and validate biomarkers. And particularly we focus on innovative biomarkers. And the reason why we do this is because we want to implement these biomarkers into personalized medicine. So we want to improve outcome of the patients. So to do this, we have an organization, and which is headed by Wienand Dinges from the Department of Pathology. And I myself, I'm responsible for the liquid biopsies. I will give you some examples there as well. But Wienand himself is responsible for the tissue-based biomarkers. And since we are working on innovative biomarkers, we also have people responsible for the technology, like Jolanda de Rijke is involved in that. Since we produce data, data analysis is a critically important component of our ACE as well. And we have two people responsible for there, Harmen van der Werken from the CCBC and Andrew Stubbs from the clinical part. And of course, methodology is very important. So standard operating procedures are important if you want to reproduce your research. But of course, we do not work alone. There's a whole list of people which are either directly involved in this ACE or which are collaborating with us. And here is a whole list, and you see that we are broadly represented in the entire institute. So biomarker discovery is actually very simple. So you have to discover biomarkers, and subsequently you have to validate the research, because if you want to implement something in the clinic, you need to validate the biomarker. So only then you know that the patient will benefit. And for that, we need well-annotated clinical specimen. You need clinical data and clinical endpoints recorded. And reproducible methodology, I cannot say this enough. This is very essential. And of course, well-established data pipelines. And this is what we call the FAIR principles. And that's how biomarker research is done in the current situation. So, and to describe a little bit our methodology, and I'll give you some examples. So that's what I'm going to talk about in the next few slides, is what can we do and what can we deliver. And here is actually a little bit the routine technologies which are available, particularly in the Department of Pathology, like immunohistochemistry, where you can measure in situ stainings, the same for FISH, in situ hybridization, RNA in situ, so you can measure RNA molecules in tissues. On top of that, we have methylation arrays where we can characterize tumor tissues. And for the diagnostic these days, it's also becoming critically more and more important to do next generation sequencing to identify mutations which are present in a cancer, which are essential for the diagnosis and the treatment of patients. But of course, for the exploration, we do various genomic research, so we sequence complete genomes of exomes of patients, and we do RNA sequencing to look at the transcriptome, and also if you want to look at the proteins which are also present and biologically important, we do mass spectrometry, but these things are often done in collaboration with the core facilities we have in our institute. So this is how we envision tissue-based diagnostics is done these days. So for that, important is now we do need tissues, so we have tumor banks either stored as frozen material or as paraffin embedded material, which is large numbers available. But on top of that, these days we also focus more and more on liquid biopsy, which is basically blood samples or urine samples from patients or any other fluid from patients which can be analyzed for markers. So this is a little bit the basics of the research, but I'll give you now a few examples of top-notch biomarker research in our institute, not necessarily only done by me, but done by our ACE or in collaborated with our ACE. So here's the first example, which is actually where we not measure static components, but we actively work with living tissue to determine whether a tissue lacks or has a certain biological function. And this is done by Dick van Gent together with Agnes Jager in our group, where we look at double-strand DNA, a functional assay on a double-strand DNA repair deficiency. So we really get patient material living in the lab, and we read out using this complex assay how whether a cancer can repair DNA or not. So, and here is a quantitative readout of those results, and we see on the left that there is a subgroup of patients which cannot repair DNA, and this is critically important because we believe those patients are sensitive to a particular type of therapy, which is cisplatin-based or PARP inhibitors. So we really need a functional readout to be able to identify those patients, and we can do that in our institute. The other thing is a complete different thing. We can analyze the entire genome, so we can count all the bases and we can see what's wrong in the cancers. And here is just an example of a study I did where we identify the mutational programs which are present in cancers. This is breast cancer. And as you see three main subgroups, which are the age-related cancers, which are basically the more indolent cancers, and which patients acquire mutations over time due to aging. But two other important phenotypes are there. I come again back to the DNA repair deficiency. There's a subgroup of cancers, not only hereditary cancers, but look a lot like BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutated cancers, which are genes involved in DNA repair deficiency and hereditary breast cancer. And they can be identified by the specific mutations and the specific rearrangements which are present in a cancer. And then the third group, there's APOBEC mutagenesis, which is a specific mechanism, which is actually an enzyme which should not be present in normal breast tissue, but is induced. We don't know why, but it causes lots of mutations in those cancers. And what you also see here is that particularly the APOBEC and the BRCA cancers, you see much more frequent in metastatic breast cancer, which means that those mechanism apparently are involved in driving progression or treatment resistance. And from these signatures, they also are important for determining the treatment. As I said, the BRCA1 and BRCA2 like cancers are probably sensitive for DNA repair drugs like PARPs and cisplatin. I mentioned them already. And we've noted that these APOBEC like cancers, they have a specific mutation profile, and we believe they are sensitive to, for instance, PIK3CA inhibitors because they have dual PIK3CA mutations. So from this information, we can also derive biomarkers which are critically important for treatment. So these are two innovative biomarkers which we can measure on tissues. But I also can show you here that we can also do a lot with blood of patients these days. And particularly, we have machines available to extract tumor cells from the patients, and we can count them and do gene expression and genomic profiling on them. We can even grow tissues from them, organoids, so we can analyze metastatic patient material which is shed into the blood. Apart from living cells, we can also find nucleic acids in the blood of patients, and we have a panel of assays to identify aberrations which are present. So we can do that, and I'll show you a couple of examples as well. Exosomes, which are vesicles, which are also secreted by tumor cells, can also be characterized. I'm not going to talk about that today, but it's another phenotype which can be measured in our patients. So here, one example. This is prostate cancer, where we can isolate circulating tumor cells from the blood, and we can measure androgen receptors. Androgens are critically important for driving prostate cancer, and we can measure specific splice variants which are active independent of androgens, which are believed to cause resistance. So we can extract cells from the blood where we can measure the splice variant, and on the right side you can clearly see that on the top panel, patients which have this variant fail therapy on the top level, but they do respond to chemotherapy. So we do have a biomarker here, which we now have validated. So we can measure this within 1 week, and we can report back to the doctors. So this biomarker theoretically can be implemented in the clinic. So another important thing is that we can now get those cells in hand pure. This was initially not possible. So we have two machines. One, extract the cells from the blood. Cells pick the individual tumor cells, and we can do genomic profiling on those tumor cells as well with these two machines which are in our institute available for all of you. So these are the cells, but now we go back to the DNA. So there's a little bit of DNA from tumor material also measurable in the blood, and that we can also analyze for particular mutations. Here is an example in colorectal cancer. And you should be aware that there's very little DNA there to be detected, so you need very sensitive sequencing methods, which are unimolecular next-generation sequencing, which we have available in our institute, to be able to analyze the little bit of DNA from the tumor which is available. And here I show you some results from a study where we did in colorectal cancer, where patients are treated with cetuximab, and patients should be wild type for downstream MAP kinase molecules like RAS and RAF. Only then this treatment works. But if you look in the patients, then we can analyze what's really happening during treatment. So that's what we did. So we analyzed patients which were on the diagnostic sample wild type for KRAS and other RAS pathway mutations. But we then sampled the blood at the start of treatment and at progression, and I'll show you the results of both the non-responders and the responders. And the important thing is, in the non-responders, we noted that there is already in the blood resistance mutations which are present already at the start of treatment. That probably explains why these patients do not respond. So, and also during treatment, nothing is happening in these patients. In the non-responders, there are no upfront mutations present, but if you look during treatment, you see resistant mutations arising during treatment. So we believe that we can measure in blood using this marker to see whether patients are failing treatment. So this is another biomarker which can be used to personalize treatment. The last biomarker which I'll discuss is the biomarker is methylation sequencing. So that little amount of tumor DNA which is present in the blood, we can also do methylation profiling. And two things that's relevant for methylation. From methylation patterns, you can identify the cell type, where it's derived from. And also, you can identify the tumor suppressor genes which are silenced during tumor progression. And actually, this is a technique developed by Joost Kripnau in our institute, and which was initially identified to do study X chromosome inactivation, but he noted that this can be used for whole genome methylation profiling, and we established the method that it also works on blood. And the fact on the right, you see one of the first examples there that we can discriminate on the right and on the left cancer patients from healthy individuals. And we believe that this is a universal marker for monitoring disease, particularly in cancer, because every cancer can be identified by his specific DNA methylation pattern. a critically important thing is biomarkers. You first have to discover their clinical significance, but I think you have to go all the way to the clinic, and therefore you have to do retrospective and prospective validation. And this is really a long shot. UP8x1 was developed in our lab already in the previous century, and it took like 10 years to get this biomarker, but this is currently in the ASCO guidelines for patients with breast cancer. Similar is true for PTX2 DNA methylation, which actually we discovered ourselves in the lab in 2002, and only a couple of years ago, the first IVD test was available in the clinic. So you should be aware that next to biomarker discovery, which is critically important to understand biology, if you want to help the patient, you need to bring it to the clinic. And a couple of things are important is clinical utility. So the biomarker, what it makes, if you can measure it, what difference does it make for the patient? It needs to be useful for the patient. Most biomarkers are not useful enough because they are not strong enough to be relevant, to be used in patients. And another thing which is there, the robustness. An assay needs to be robust, and also the clinical value of the assay needs to be robust. So these important steps are often forgotten by biomarker research, but this is exactly what we want to deliver as well. So to conclude, our ACE is able to deliver innovative diagnostics to our patients and to really make personalized medicine happening. So if you're interested in that, please approach me or any other of our ACE to make this happen. And I would like to thank you for your attention. My name is John Martens, and I'm working on the Department of Medical Oncology.